This video will walk you through the disassembly and reassembly of the Microsoft Surface Laptop Go 3. Before you begin this repair, power off the device and disconnect it from its power supply. Unplug all cables and drives, and fully discharge the battery by running a resource-intensive application or playing a video. Check that your work surface is clean and clear of any debris or abrasive particles, and covered with an ESD-safe, non-marring material. And lastly, put on an anti-static wrist strap and make sure that your work area is properly grounded and safe. With the display closed, flip the laptop over so that the non-skid feet are facing up. Insert a spudger at the end of the foot pad and slide it under the foot until you can grab it with your fingers. Peel up and remove the foot. Repeat this procedure for the second foot pad. There are keyboard assemblies with and without a fingerprint reader. When doing a keyboard assembly replacement, make sure you're replacing the cover with one that matches the original. Keyboard assemblies without a fingerprint reader will have a small bump in the upper right-hand corner of the power button. Use a Phillips screwdriver to remove the 7 screws from the foot recesses. The screws are not all the same length, so make sure to note exactly where each screw came from. Once all the screws are removed, open the laptop 90 degrees, display side down. The keyboard assembly is secured to the chassis by several plastic clips. To release them, use a plastic opening tool to pry between the front edge of the keyboard assembly and the chassis. Release the clips by rotating the opening tool about 15 degrees to create a gap between the keyboard assembly and the chassis. You should hear a soft popping sound as the clips release. Slide the opening tool along the right edge, releasing the clips along that edge. And then rotate the laptop to release the clips along the left edge of the device. The final four vent clips will remain engaged for now. Place the laptop down with the keyboard facing up. Gently press the upper edge of the keyboard assembly down and lift the bottom edge to disengage the remaining four clips along the hinge. Rotate the keyboard assembly up, making sure not to strain the cable, and then hold it in place. Use a spudger to lift the hinge locking flap on the keyboard cable, and then use your finger to pull the cable straight out. The keyboard assembly should now lift right off. When storing the keyboard assembly, make sure it's protected from cosmetic damage and that the cables lie flat, not bent or creased. Before continuing with any repair, perform the following safety checks. First, inspect the battery for damage. There should be no evidence of leaking, dents, swelling, surface scratches, damaged wires, discoloration, or any signs of corrosion, such as visual signs or the presence of a smell like acetone. Next, inspect the liquid damage indicator square above the rSSD. If it's any color other than white, the whole device should be replaced. Check the keyboard assembly and chassis for any damage to the clips, inspecting the perimeter of the keyboard assembly and the four chassis clips below the device's hinge. If you spot any damage, the keyboard assembly should be replaced. Once everything's been checked, use the flat edge of a spudger to lift the hinge locking flap on the battery's cable connector, and then lift the battery cable and pull it straight out of its socket. For safety, place a battery cover over the laptop so that it completely covers the battery. This protects the battery from accidental damage during a repair. Gently pry up and remove the rSSD shielding with a spudger starting in the upper left-hand corner. The rSSD is secured by a single Phillips screw. Remove that and then use an opening pick to gently lift the rSSD up until it clears the screw post. While holding the pick in place, insert the tip of your spudger into the hole in the rSSD's top left corner and slide it out of its socket. Use the flat end of your spudger to scrape up and remove the entire rSSD thermal pad from the motherboard, and then use some cotton swabs and isopropyl alcohol to remove any of the thermal pad residue. To remove the battery, begin by removing the four Phillips screws securing it to the chassis. With all the screws removed, lift the battery by grabbing a screw bracket with your finger and lift it out. To remove the display, begin by removing the four Phillips screws securing the heatsink, making sure to remove them in the order stamped next to the screw hole. Use your spudger to lift an edge of the heatsink to separate it from the CPU, and then lift the heatsink out of the chassis. Remove the antenna cable's cover, and then disconnect the antenna cables. Peel the cables up to completely free them from the motherboard. Unlatch the display cable's buckle, and then slide the cable straight out of its socket to disconnect the display. Remove the two bottom hinge screws, and then raise the display to a 90-degree angle. While supporting the display with your hand, remove the two upper hinge screws. With the screws removed, the display should lift right out. To remove the surface connect port, remove the three Phillips screws securing the bracket, and then lift it up and out. Unlock the surface connect port's cable connector and slide the cable back to disconnect it. Deroute the cable from around the fan and then lift the surface connect port out. Use the point of a spudger to push on alternating sides of the fan's cable connector to walk it out of its socket. Next, use a Phillips screwdriver to remove the three screws securing the fan, and then lift the fan straight up to remove it. There are two Phillips screws securing the metal bracket to the top left corner of the enclosure. Remove those screws and then lift the bracket out. Use the point of a spudger to push on alternating sides of the speaker cable connector to walk it out of its socket, and then remove the final two Phillips screws securing the motherboard. Lift the right edge of the motherboard and slide it out of its recess. Insert the motherboard at a slight downward angle so the ports on the left side go into their recesses, while lowering the board into place, ensure that no cables have been trapped underneath the board. Use a Phillips screwdriver to install the two motherboard screws, and then set the upper left bracket back into place. Secure the bracket to the chassis with two Phillips screws. Put the fan into place and use a Phillips screwdriver to install the three fan screws. Reconnect the fan and speaker cables, making sure they are fully seated in their sockets. Place the surface connect port assembly into the chassis and then route its cable around the fan. Reconnect and lock its cable, and then place the surface connect port bracket back into place and reinstall the three screws securing it to the chassis. Make sure the display's hinges are set to a 90-degree angle, and then set the new display into place using the alignment posts to align both hinges. Secure the display by installing the two upper hinge screws. Next, install the two lower hinge screws. Insert the display cable and then lock it into place. Make sure the antenna cables are secure under their clip near the right edge, and then re-adhere them above the fan. Reconnect the two antenna cables, and then reapply the antenna cable shield. Clean off any thermal paste remaining on the CPU, and then install a new heatsink. The new heatsink will have pre-installed thermal paste on its underside. Tighten the heatsink screws in order based on the number stamped next to each screw hole. Using the provided loops on the new battery, lower it into place in the chassis, making sure to seat the tabs along the front edge properly. Once the battery is properly seated, reinstall the four screws securing the battery to the chassis. Remove the plastic covering and place the battery cover back on. Remove the backing from a new rSSD thermal pad and place it where the old thermal pad was. Insert the rSSD at a slight downward angle and then use your finger to press it completely into its socket. Install the new rSSD screw, and then reinstall the new rSSD shield. Replace the rSSD thermal pads, making sure to clean off any adhesive residue before installing the new pad. Remove the battery cover from the laptop, and then check for any loose articles that may be present within the device enclosure areas, around the speaker magnets, the area around the battery cover, and both sides of the keyboard assembly. Next, slide the battery's cable into place and press down on the locking tab to secure it. Hold the keyboard assembly over the device so that the cable can reach its connector easily, and then slide it into place. Once it's in place, press down on the locking tab to secure it. Use the four front edge alignment posts to orient the keyboard assembly on the device. Once it's aligned, lower it into place. Press down on the perimeter of the keyboard assembly to engage all the clips. Start with the edge closest to the hinges, and then work your way down the left and right edges, finishing with the bottom edge. Before installing new screws, verify that the laptop is functioning properly. Plug the device in and run Surface Diagnostic Toolkit Battery Repair Validation. Features and functions operate as expected. Power off the device, disconnect it from power, and continue the reassembly. Double check that the keyboard assembly is properly clipped in, and then close the display and flip the device over. Reinstall new screws to secure the keyboard assembly to the chassis. Before reinstalling the non-skid feet, Clean the foot recesses with some isopropyl alcohol to remove any adhesive residue. Lay out your replacement non-skid feet, noting that the feet are different. The rear foot has one alignment peg, while the front foot has two. Once the recesses are dry, remove the protective sheet to expose the adhesive on a new rear non-skid foot. Lay it into place, making sure the alignment post goes into the cutout near the top left corner. Press the foot firmly into place, making sure it's completely adhered. Repeat this process for the front foot, making sure both of the alignment pegs go into their cutouts in the recess. Check that the newly installed feet have no signs of gaps or cosmetic damage. If you see any, remove the foot and replace it. Finally, let the device sit feet down for at least 12 hours to make sure the adhesive fully bonds.